myself Mahendra Subhash Khairnar, an assistant professor in law. So let's start. Today we'll see the school of Realis School of Jurisprudence, which is very important part of jurisprudence. Realis School or American Legal Realism is the latest development in the field of jurisprudence. In this video, we are going to see the meaning of legal realism, skepticism, what is meant by formalism, the concept of legal realism in length and breadth, and various jurists who have contributed towards American legal realism. There is Oliver Holmes, Carl Levlin, Jeremy Frank, and John Chipman Gray. There are many other jurists, but here we are going to study the theories of these four jurists. So let's understand what is the meaning of legal realism. Legal realism is a theory that all law derives from prevailing social interest and public policy. Schools of jurisprudence are related with the ideology that what is the development of law, what is the source of development of law, and why the law has been developed. These legal realists are of the view that the law is derived from prevailing social interest. Prevailing means the contemporary or in the present scenario. The social interest as well as public policy means the policy which the public community has adopted. The jurists have emphasized on the social interest and public policy. In English speaking countries or in Commonwealth countries, this frame of legal realism has a more restricted meaning, because in English speaking countries we have understood the word legal realism in the sense that it is the law made by the judiciary, and therefore this is a quite complicated term to understand. It is used to refer a conception of adjudication rather than of law in general. This legal realism is relating to the concept of adjudication. It is the process and power of adjudication, and how the judges derive to their decision is discussed in this legal realism, and therefore this is also known as a judge-made law. Moving further, the legal realism is also called as American legal realism because it is the field which has been developed in America, particularly in American Supreme Court. As we know that the America has adopted the power of the doctrine of separation of power, and therefore in America there is a complete separation of power between judiciary, executive and legislative. The US Supreme Court has a specific domain over the judicial field, and therefore American legal realism is seen as the activity of courts and other state officials who are acting in quasi-judicial capacity. Therefore, realists are interested in methods of predicting judges with more accuracy. Means the schools of realism studies the judges, and therefore this is also known as a judgment, that is a J-U-D-G-E, judge statement. The legal realism is the outcome of legal skepticism. Then what is the legal skepticism? We are going to see that. The skepticism is a quite confusing concept. Let's understand it in better manner. Skepticism in law is a school of jurisprudence that was a reaction against the idea of natural law and a response to the formalism of legal positivist. We have seen in our earlier video what is the natural school of law and what is the positive school of law. The natural law believers believe that the law is made by the God, or the law is within the morality of an individual. Whereas legal positivists are opposed to this view, and they said that the law is an outcome of man-made procedure, and therefore the law is the only law which is made by the man, that is by parliament or by political superior authority. And while framing such a law, it must have certain formalism, that is a certain procedure, and therefore legal positivists do believe in formalism, and therefore skepticism is the reaction to the natural law. The skepticism in American, Canadian or British and Australian concepts, it is considered as a philosophical approach that includes a scientific method and a rejection of unevidence claims to certainty. Dear friends, try to understand the bold letter. The skepticism is interested in rejection of unevidenced, means which is not proved, the thing which has no sense, the thing which is fictional is rejected by the skepticism, and therefore this has further developed in a legal positivism, and the legal positivism further developed in legal realism. Here we understand the relation between skepticism and realism. Skepticism says that it is a rejection of unevidenced evidence which is appreciated in the court of law, and therefore it is only the courts who can find the real law according to realist. Therefore there is a definite relationship between skepticism and realism. Now let's understand what is legal realism. According to this theory, that is the theory of legal realism, judges considered not only abstract rules but also social interest and public policy when deciding a case. Means the judge cannot depend upon the black letters of law, but the judge has to consider the social interest and public policy while deciding a case. Means he cannot only the mouthpiece of parliament, he should consider the social interest and public policy while deciding a case. And therefore the concept of legal realism is different from legal formalism. Legal formalism is more concerned with the parliamentary affairs or the enactment of the law. Therefore realism differs from legal formalism. This concept is quite confusing. Please be with me for better understanding of the concept of legal realism. First, we understand the legal formalism. As we know, legal realism is the outcome or the reaction to the legal formalism. Therefore, we must understand what is a legal formalism, which was developed in the 19th and 20th century due to the positivist approach of Bentham and Austin. Legal formalism is depend upon the two theories, that is a descriptive theory and normative theory. Legal formalism is both descriptive theory and normative theory, which these two theories are concerned with the nature that how judges should decide the case. Let's understand. Legal realism is a reaction to legal formalism. It is clear now. And legal formalism has the combination of descriptive theory and normative theory. Here, in a descriptive sense, the formalists believe that the judges reach their decisions by applying uncontroversial principles to the fact. Dear friends, kindly read the colored letters and bold letters with a great sense. In descriptive sense, formalists believe, whereas in normative sense, the formalist is of the view that the judges should decide the case by the application of uncontroversial principles to the facts. It is agreed that the judges shall apply the uncontroversial principles to the fact, means uncontroversial law or enacted law to the facts. It is clear, but descriptive sense of formalist approach says that it is believed that judges reach their decision, whereas normative sense believe that judges should decide the case. Means this is the approach towards the studying the approach of judges towards deciding the cases. We'll have some more clarification on this point. Legal realism is a naturalistic approach to law. What is a naturalistic? We'll understand it. It is the view that jurisprudence should follow the method of natural sciences. Natural sciences which relies on empirical evidence, that is evidence which can be tested in the laboratory, evidence which has certain empirical value or the practical value. And accordingly, the legal science should also have the practical value, it should be tested in the society itself. And therefore, for law, society is a laboratory. It is a social science. Therefore, law should be studied in social context. Further, we know that the natural science, which is also known as the naturalism, is a branch of science which is concerned with the description, prediction, and understanding of natural phenomena, which is based on empirical evidence. For example, the Newton's law, E is equal to mc square, or the apple falls from the tree to the down. This is a what we can say, pure science. And legal science is also a science according to this realist. Further, in a philosophy, naturalism is the idea or belief that only laws, only natural laws and forces operate in the universe. In the similar fashion, legal realism is the science, is the idea or the belief of jurisprudence, which says that the judges have only capacity to operate or follow the law, because judges gives empirical value to the law. Judges give practical value or real value to the black letters of law in the statute. Therefore, we'll have more clarification on this point. Legal realists believe that legal science should only investigate law with the value-free methods of natural sciences, like a natural science which studies the science, like a chemistry, biology, physics, etc. Value-free methods means they study the physics in its strict context. Likewise, the law should be studied in its strict sense by a jurist. Therefore, American legal realists believe that there is a more to adjudication than the mechanical application of known legal principles. Means the judges not only apply the law in its mechanical sense, but the judges do consider more things while adjudicating. Now, what judges think more to adjudication or while adjudicating is the subject matter of legal realism. How the judge think, how the judge has influence through his upbringing or through his environment, that is the subject matter of legal realism. Okay, we'll have more clarification now. Some realists believe that one can never be sure that the facts and law identified in the judge's reason were the actual reasons for the judgment. Means here realists are discussing between themselves that judge's reason means the logical reasoning which is cited by the judge in his decision, which is based on the facts and law. It shall be based on actual reasoning. Whereas, according to some jurists, a judge's reason can often be relied upon, but not all the time. Means, we can question the reasoning, we can question the logic which is applied by the judge. The judge is not the supreme authority, but his decision can be questioned by way of further reading or further academic development. And therefore, legal realism believe that the judge's decision is open for scrutiny. There are many other jurists who have contributed towards the legal realism. These leading legal jurists are Oliver Holmes, Carl Levlin, Jeremy Frank, and John Chipman Gray. There are many other jurists who have contributed towards the development of legal realism, but we are going to study these American jurists who have contributed heavily in the field of realist jurisprudence. First one is Oliver Holmes. He himself is an American jurist and associated with the justice system of America. He was an associate justice at Supreme Court of US almost for 30 years. And he was also acting as a chief justice of Supreme Court of America during 1930. He has created different theories towards the legal realism. These are prediction theory of law, realist approach, and Badman theory of law. So let's study the Oliver Holmes, who is considered as a father of American legal realism. Oliver Wendell Holmes is a towering figure in American legal thought. He has created his own brand, his own image in the jurisprudence era. He is famous for his prediction theory of law. He was also known for his utilitarian approach to legal reasoning. He considered the law from its practical point of view, and therefore he is always insisting on the realist insistence, means the law should be real, the law should help the society as such. It should not be only the academic juxtaposure, and therefore the law should be real one. The Hobbes philosophy of law can be stated that the life of the law has not been logic, but it has been experience. The development of law depends upon the experience that a judge, that a society, that a legislature takes. The law is not simply the logic, but it is more of experience in nature. And therefore, how is the experience decides how is the law. Next, we'll understand his prediction theory of law. According to Hume, he has given a pragmatic definition of law. He says that the prophecies of what the court will do in fact and nothing more pretentious are what I mean by the law. Means if we are going to prophesy, means guess what is the law, then we can answer that the law is what the court will do in fact. That judges in deciding cases are not simply deducing legal conclusions with inexorable machine like logic, means judges are not giving only logic, they are not giving only legal conclusions, but judges are influenced by ideas of fairness, public policy and other personal and conventional values. Means we should understand the upbringing of judge, his background, what theory have influenced the judge and all that, because judge is also an organic human being who has certain psychological impact of his reading, and therefore his decision is always influenced by the idea of fairness and public policy. The another theory which is propounded by Oliver Holmes is a Badman theory of law, which is very celebrated theory. According to him, if you want to know the real law and nothing else, then you must consider it from the point of view of Badman. Means according to Holmes, it is only the Badman who consider the law in its practical situation, because Badman cares only for material consequences of the court's decision, because it is only the court who execute the law, who can give the punishment or fine to the person who is infringing the law, and therefore the law should be understood from the point of view of Badman. Badman means a person who is not following the law or who is a violator of law, and therefore we should understand the law from his perspective. The Badman theory of law further developed that according to Holmes, the Badman find that he does not care of two things. First, morality or the logic of the law. The Badman or the person who is always violating the law, the accused who is least care about the morality and the logics of the law, and therefore he can be corrected through the punishment only. And therefore for the Badman, legal duty signifies only a prophecy that if he does certain things, he will be subjected to imprisonment or compulsory payment by court of law. And therefore, the Badman thinks the legal duty when there is a punishment or a sanction behind the law, which can be executed only by the court of law. Therefore, the Badman cares nothing for legal theorizing and concern himself only with the practical consequences. The Badman does not care about the morality and the logic of the law or what will be the impact of his action. Therefore, he has to suffer a practical consequences, that is a punishment. The next jurist is Carl Levlin, who is also an American jurist. Carl Levlin has proposed that the fact and outcome of specific cases compose the law. Means, whenever the judge delivers his decision by way of analyzing the facts, then the outcome of that case is considered as a law and nothing more. Let's understand him. According to Levlin, he epitomized the realist view. He has given his own realist view. According to him, what judges, lawyers, and law enforcement officers do about disputes is the law itself. Means, whatever action, whatever decision has been taken by judges, lawyers, and law enforcement officers or the quasi-judicial officers, their decision, their action is considered as a law in practical sense. He is one of the founders of the US legal realism movement, and therefore the Levlin has contributed so much towards the branch of jurisprudence. Levlin has believed that the law is little more than putty in the hands of judges who is able to shape the outcome of case based on personal biases. Means, not only the black letters of law is sufficient to deliver the judgment or the decision of the court, but it requires more thing, and that more thing is within the judge itself, that his personal bias do play a pivotal role in giving shape to the outcome of a case, that is decision. And the decision depends upon the personality, the nature, and overall image of the judge. The next legal realist is a Jeremy Frank. He is also an American jurist. He was a judge in the American court. He has written a book, Law and the Modern Mind, in 1930. And he believed that the psychological forces do work in legal matters. Means, the psychological force has a more authority than the black letters of law. According to Frank, in his book, Law and Modern Mind, he argued against the basic legal myth. There is a legal myth that judge can never make a law. It is, according to him, it is a myth. This is not a true that judge cannot make the law. But judge can only make the law. How? Because judge do not simply deduce legal conclusions from premises that care clear, certain, as substantially unchanging. But judges do make the law through his judicial decisions, because his judicial decisions are motivated primarily by the influence of psychological factors on the individual judge. And therefore, we can firmly say that the judge can make the law. And therefore, this is known as a judicial law, which has more binding authority. Jeremy Frank has urged judges and legal scholars to acknowledge openly the gaps and uncertainties in the law, and to think of law pragmatically as a tool for human betterment. And this is the judgment, this is the sentence which has promoted legal activism or legal realism in its broad sense throughout the Commonwealth nations. The whatever gap, whatever uncertainty which has been seen by the judges in the law, then the judge shall come forward for the human betterment. And therefore, he should think a law pragmatically in its practical approach. Then the next judge is John Gipman Gray. He was also American jurist and judge. Who said that the statutes and constitution are inanimate objects which cannot speak by themselves. It is agreed that the statute and constitution are dead letters unless and until it is delivered by the judge through his decision. And therefore, this has given rise to the concept of judicial review and concept of judicial activism. Further, Gray has said the statute do not interpret themselves. The interpretation is the part of judiciary, and therefore द मीनिंग ऑफ द स्टैट्यूट इज डिक्लेयर्ड बाय द कोर्ट्स एंड इट इज विद इन मीनिंग डिक्लेयर्ड बाय द कोर्ट्स एंड विथ नो अदर मीनिंग दैट दे आर इम्पोज्ड अपॉन द कम्युनिटी एज अ लॉ मीन्स द नेचर द मीनिंग ऑफ अ स्टैट्यूट depends upon the declaration, the decision of the court, and therefore the court gives a practical value to the statutory enactment. Further, the Gray has said the law has a two parts, legislative law and judgment law. Legislative law is the law made by the parliament or the lawmaking authority, and it is given to the judges and lawyers who can interpret and who can execute the law in its true sense. And therefore, he says, in reality, in truth, all the law is a judge-made law. Law is made by the judge. The court puts life into the dead words of the statute. Unless and until the law is delivered by the judge through his decision, it has only a dead letter of law. And therefore, we know that in India, the Supreme Court has played a pivotal role in giving life to the wordings of Article 19 and moreover Article 21, that is the right to life and personal liberty. The Supreme Court has interpreted the analogy of right to life in its different ambit and scope, which we have seen in our earlier videos. Kindly go through it. I hope you have liked the video. Please like, subscribe and share it for better understanding of others. If you want, you can watch my more videos on my channel. I hope you like it. Thank you. Thank you very much.